there, AO. My name is Shelley Merrell. I'm here from sunny Southern California. I own a fire protection company in Ventura, California. And we basically install and maintain all types of fire protection for all types of building owners, including many government facilities. So anyway, I am here to do a mentor session and give you my take on some of these questions. So you guys got to keep asking your questions. I love getting those. It's super fun to answer them. My first question comes from Robin Turpin. From a timeline perspective, what time frame should I be looking at to hit six figures in my business? Business description is, I am an up-and-coming artist painting. I am working on building my portfolio, learning to sell, as well as my own personal development. I come from a very limited mindset, and I'm growing every day thanks to AO. How do I know if I'm on the right path? I am happy, and I know it is going slow, but how do I know if things are on the right path? How do you determine that for you? Elevator pitch as an artist, I help people feel moments of calm through my oil paintings of sunsets. And your paintings are beautiful. I really love those. So there was a few things that I picked up in that question, and one of them is your statement that you are happy. If you're happy, that means you're on a right path. That's the very first thing that I would ask somebody. Are you happy? Are you happy with what you're doing? Because if you're happy with it and it's your passion, that is going to come through always. Now, the part about when should I hit the six-figure mark, that's a very tricky question, and it's very subjective. It all depends on how many paintings you sell and how much they are. If you were able to sell 10 paintings for $100,000 each, you're gonna hit that fast, you know. If you're selling one or two paintings a year at $300 a piece, obviously it's gonna take a lot longer. So that's very subjective. I would actually have to look at your financials, which I'm not a CPA or anything like that, but I would have to look at your financials in order to even give you my perspective on that. But again, the fact that you're happy with what's going on, to me, tells me that you are on a right path. Nobody else can really answer that for you, but if I were you and I was feeling happy and proud and knowing that I'm going through my self-development, that would be enough for me to say, yeah, I'm on the right path. This feels good. You know, typically if you're on a wrong path, you do have that sneaky suspicion. You may choose to ignore it, but it's there. That little voice is telling you this is wrong. I know it's wrong. If you're all in, hey, you're doing good. Anyway, okay, the next question comes again from Robin. Thank you, Robin, for always asking questions. We all of us mentors love answering all these questions. How would you respond to a prospect who says they don't have a wall space for more art? As an artist working on location, this is often a response when a client sees and loves my art. With that, I started creating tiny drawings for tiny spaces. Thoughts? How would you overcome that objection? When I was doing painting as a hobby, I would go to those art nights, and I got kind of like addicted to going to those. So I have a bazillion paintings that are just stacked up and not on any walls because I don't have space for them. Plus, having them, I really wouldn't hang up anyway. It was more just for fun. So I do understand the people who say they don't have any more wall space for them. I do think that's a legitimate reason to not buy art. However, I would say, well, what about a gift for somebody? Or Christmas is coming up, or there might be a birthday coming up. So I would put that suggestion out to them. The tiny drawings for tiny spaces, I'd be curious to see how is that going. Are you getting positive feedback from that? Are more people buying than when you do the bigger paintings? Those are questions I would be looking at. But as far as overcoming those objections, we can never make anybody do or buy something that they just don't want to invest in. So what you're doing with pivoting and coming up with a different solution is always a good thing, you know. But as far as the objection or rejection, I kind of view that as a rejection. I just water just off of it. Let me back up. It's like water off of a duck. Don't take it personal. It is what it is. And over time, with more confidence coming through from your self-development and AO and those kind of things, I think that that just kind of builds with time and experience. Where you start not taking it personal or getting upset about it. Anyway, I hope that helps. I'm not sure that it does help, but I hope it does help. By the way, if you notice, I'm out of my neck brace. Woohoo! I'm so happy about that. I still have physical restrictions, so I'm going to have to miss the summer social in 2 weeks. Because I still can't really travel or carry luggage or anything. Granted, yes, I know I could ship my stuff to Sean's and he'd ship it back, but it's really a hassle. And I can't wait 4 more weeks and they'll hopefully give me the okay and all my physical restrictions will be lifted. I'm still super happy I did it. So for anybody going through that, I'm a testimony. If you need to have your neck fused, I had a great surgeon. I'm happy I did it. And I'm here if anybody wants to talk about it. Okay, so the next question is from Brad Letchworth. How do you know when the time is right to leave your full-time job and go all in on your business? I am currently a full-time firefighter and paramedic for a local municipality and have 13 years of service invested with 12 more of retirement. The climate has changed drastically, and although I never dreamed I would ever consider leaving the fire service, I find myself struggling to find a reason to stay. My business has been growing slowly over the last several years, but it's still not at a point where I feel comfortable leaving the guaranteed income of my fire job. However, I'm totally burned out and ready to leave. It's the fear that's holding me back and the lure of a guaranteed income and benefits that keeps me there. So how do I know when it's the right time or when I should make the leap? Well, Brad, thank you for your service, number one. I'm on the side that really, really appreciates and supports our police and fire people. I own a fire protection company, so I know a lot of firemen. And as a matter of fact, I have a committee meeting on Wednesday with the California Office of the State Fire Marshal. So thank you for what you do. It's always going to be a leap of faith. That's kind of a given. My question would be, you've got 13 years in and you've got 12 years until retirement. You've got 13 in and 12 more to go. I'm curious how beneficial is the retirement package that they offer you? I'm really, really curious. And I would seriously consider what benefits you're going to be giving up before giving them up. If it was just somebody working at a bank, you know, asking, hey, when should I do this? My answer would be when you are generating enough revenue to support your expenses and have a little bit extra to support your growth, that would be when I would do it. However, in this particular situation, I know that firemen, police, they have some pretty good retirement benefits. So I would be really weighing that out and seeing how that'll go. Because in all honesty, 12 years, looking back on life, like 12 years goes by so fast. It might not seem like it at the time. I get that. But if it's a difference of you, like say you're going to be able to draw like $5,000 or $10,000 a month or something like that, I would think twice before giving that up. But I would still continue to put as much time and energy into that business. And to keep from getting burned out, I would try to find an outlet that helps me to, helps my brain to like get away from everything for a while. For me, like I mentioned earlier, I was going to paint nights. I do a lot of different arts and crafts, and it helps me remove myself so that I can get a little bit of a recharge, because I can't go on vacation every month, you know, which would be one other way of doing that, but we can't do that. So that's what I would do. Weigh out those benefits. If your income is supporting you, if your revenue is enough to support you, pay your expenses and a cushion for growth, it might be worth letting everything else go and taking that leap. So there's some things you really, really need to think about and consider. I would like to hear what you end up doing, because it's always interesting to me when people make those kind of big life changes. How they do it, you know, that is a scary thing. So we're here for you if you need to talk. Definitely you can DM, and, you know, there's lots of people here in the group who will lend a sympathetic ear to you. Okay, the next question is from Lysandra Wilson. Hi, Lysandra. What things would you recommend I can do to get as many leads as possible and also track those leads when at a trade show? Background: I have a baking business that specializes in desserts for wedding and special events. We attend trade shows to increase awareness and get leads to offer our services for weddings. What things have you found that help get leads while at the show, and how do you track after the show? Do you do giveaways, offer discounts, open to all ideas? Thanks. Lysandra, I've never been in this situation. I don't go to trade shows. However, if I were going to a trade show, what I see a lot of people do, and it seems to work, is they'll raffle something off. Like maybe you could get Wilton to donate like a little gift package or something for, you know, cake decorating or even like a class or something like that, and then raffle it off. You can buy a roll of tickets, like amusement park tickets. You would have them put their name and email or cell phone number on the back, put it into the jar, and then when you draw the raffle and somebody wins the prize, you still have all those tickets with that information. people also use business cards for that. They'll have a fishbowl and say, hey, drop your business card in here. And they use that to do all of their follow-up and marketing and whatnot. That's what I would do. I would entice them with something that they could want to win and then get them to fill that out as much as possible. And then you've got all those leads right there. I hope that helps. Okay. Next question is from Rosalie. Hi, Rosalie. Okay, what are the best ways to discuss work performance concerns with team members in a way that will help them improve rather than feel frustrated? Background: I have an accounting firm. When a team member gets stuck with client's work, I jump on a call with them and resolve the issue almost immediately. I have seen them get frustrated and embarrassed with themselves. How can I better these conversations so we leave feeling great and positive? One of the things that JT had taught us and Sean talks about here is having a daily huddle. So it's a quick 10-minute daily huddle. Everybody has to attend. You set it at an odd time, like say you start work at 9 o'clock, so you'd set it for like 9:07, and it'd be 9:07. You could take that time, a quick 10-minute meeting, to just kind of throw out a quick, like each person could say a quick maybe problem that they're having. And it could be thrown out there, and then everybody kind of talk about it or resolve it, or at least throw it out there as an issue that they're having. Then, when I've had to have these talks with people, typically I already have a solution in mind before I go into a meeting like this, if it's one-on-one. I have a solution already in mind, and so my people usually leave fairly happy. But if somebody was leaving frustrated, I think I would say a lot of things along the lines of, what can I do to help you do this thing better? You know, that way it shows them that you're willing to put in time and energy into helping them get better. People shouldn't need so much reassurance, but unfortunately they do. You know, people are interesting creatures, emotional creatures. You could also end the meeting with, do you have any questions for me? That might help them to feel like they're being heard and not frustrated. I think a lot of understanding goes into play. Maybe after you've resolved the situation and before that person can feel the frustration, you could go back to them and say, hey, so-and-so had this problem. I knew how to fix it because I went through this problem back at this time. And maybe just give them a quick tidbit story. You don't want it taking a whole lot of time. But at the same time, you want your employees to feel, you know, satisfied and accomplished and that they're contributing. So those are the things I would consider doing if I were in that situation. Okay, our next question is from Kelly Killingsworth. Kelly, I'm sorry we still haven't had a chance to catch up. I'm almost back on track here at work, and then shoot me a DM and we'll connect up. Let's see. The question is, how do you deal with feeling vulnerable and anxious after letting everyone know everything about your business and what you are all about? Background. We strive for excellence as an excavation company specializing in trenching, site prep, road work, aggregate hauling, and heavy equipment operations. I'm feeling really vulnerable right now and super anxious. I'm going to all general contractors, the city halls, Cal Fire, residential builders, social media platforms, and generally letting it all hang out, trying to land a job or subcontract. I didn't expect to feel like I am feeling right now. Okay, that was the end of that. Okay, so my answer to this is there is nothing that I say to my customers or potential customers that makes me feel vulnerable and anxious. So I'm wondering, what exactly are you putting out there and saying? Truth and transparency will always win in the end. So I am a firm believer in being as honest and transparent as possible, but yet there is a line where certain things are just nobody else's business. Are you telling them your how much revenue you're making or how much net income you have? Those are types of things I wouldn't particularly share. So I'm curious what it is that you're sharing that makes you feel anxious. Typically, thinking about the future creates anxiety. Thinking about the past creates depression. So I'm curious about this. I would like to know more, actually. But it's okay to keep some things under your hat. You know, you don't want enough information out there that another excavation company could be poaching your potential customers either. So like the way you estimate things, I don't think that's anybody's business. So I'm curious what all you're putting out there. I hope that helps. It doesn't really help. I rarely feel, I've never felt vulnerable or anxious about telling anybody anything about my company, except for if I were like disclosing financials and stuff like that, that would make me very, very anxious. So again, just more information would be good. I'd like to hear more on that. Okay, this is my last question. Eric Blandino. Hi, Eric. Is it an HR problem to tell team members to eat breakfast, lunch, and take care of their personal vehicles? We are in the business of giving people their homes back from the invasion of rats. Over the years, I've noticed our team members usually don't eat breakfast or lunch, and their personal vehicles don't get maintained. This has caused a lack of energy and forgetfulness throughout the day and missed days from not being able to drive to work. They get paid over scale for our industry, and we operate in California. Yeah, California is a tricky one, that's for sure. excuse me. Lunch breaks are state law, and those need to even be documented on a time card, according to our state Department of Labor. So a couple of things could be addressed in your employee handbook as far as your expectation for readiness for the day. I wouldn't come right out and tell somebody, hey, you need to eat breakfast. That is a personal thing, and not everybody eats breakfast. Not everybody wants to eat breakfast. However, the breaks and the lunch breaks, those are state law. And if you do nothing else, make sure they are taking those and documenting them, because that can be a real problem. Regarding the personal vehicles, are they driving their personal vehicles to your jobs? I'm just curious about that because if they are, again, that could be in your employee handbook that you are creating, well, you're getting rid of rats, which are very, very dirty. So you're trying to promote cleanliness. And so I would say something about, you know, the reputation. We have a reputation for cleanliness and we don't want that to be tarnished with dirty vehicles. You know, that kind of stuff could be in the handbook. And as far as saying something to them directly, I'm not sure that you can. I would highly recommend consulting with your HR person and asking that question, but in California, it's real sticky what you can say to an employee. I have another question for you though. Like if they're driving their vehicles to your job sites, are you reimbursing them for the wear and tear? Because there is a per diem you're supposed to reimburse them. So that's not a part of this, but I just want to make sure. I don't want to see you get into any trouble. Okay, so that is the end of the questions. I don't see any other questions. Robin, thank you so much. Always love your questions. Anyway, I hope you all have a wonderful night. Keep asking questions. We do enjoy answering them every month. And we're here for you to support however we can. If anybody who's answered a question wants to talk more about their topic, my answer, any of that, definitely feel free to DM, reach out. We're here for you. So you all have a wonderful night.